individuals belong to the same species if they can sire fertile offspring. DNA replication and transfer from one generation to the next is amazingly precise. However, a tiny number of errors do nevertheless appear during replication, and they are the source of all variation in nature and are essential for evolution. If replication would have been perfect without any errors, evolution would have stopped for the lack of variation.
On the other hand, if replication fidelity would have been too low, heritability would have been adversely affected, as traits would not be transmitted faithfully from one generation to the next.
Effective evolution thus requires that replication fidelity has to be just right. Changes in DNA are called mutations. Mutations occur due to error in DNA replication or due to external causes like radiation from the sun or other sources and exposure to many chemicals. Cigarette smoke, for example, is highly mutagenic and can mutate DNA in lung cells and transform them into cancer cells.
Mutations are random, and every subunit in our DNA stands a similar chance for being mutated. The probability that a mutation will be harmful is thus much higher than for it being beneficial. If we change a letter on a page, it is very likely that it will render a word meaningless or out of context, and much, much less likely that it will improve the text. However, improvements, though less common, do happen. After all the magnificent life on Earth evolved by random mutations from very simple bacteria. We already learned that all living organisms are the offspring of existing living ones. The same is true for species. All species evolved from existing ones. There are two ways a new species can evolve. The first, which is probably more common and simpler to explain, is when two populations of a species become separated. When this happens, these populations change gradually and drift apart. Changes can be either random and meaningless or due to selection by the different ecological conditions. At a certain stage, individuals of these two populations can no longer sire fertile offspring when they meet, and they belong now to two different species. Let us consider, for example, the habitat of these brown lizards. At some stage, a river appeared and split the lizard population into two separate ones. The left area also became green thanks to the water. A random mutation in one of the lizards changed its color to green in a heritable manner. The offspring of this mutant lizard benefited from improved camouflage compared to the original brown-colored non-mutants, and fell thus less victim to predators. This selective advantage led to a gradual takeover of the left area by green lizards. Over time, additional, less conspicuous random mutations accumulated in the populations on the left and the right banks of the river. When the river dried out, it turned out that these mutations prevent the green and the brown lizards from interbreeding, so that we have now two different species that live together in the same habitat. The finches Darwin discovered on the Galapagos Islands are the most well-known example of such speciation. Each species has a distinct beak that is adapted to the type of food available on the island it inhabits. In fact, these bird species differ so much from each other that Darwin did not recognize how close they are. Only the bird expert John Gould identified that they are all finches. Darwin concluded that all these finches must have had a common ancestor. This observation and insight were important triggers to the conception of the theory of evolution that Darwin described in his book, The Origin of Species. Geographical separation is, however, not the only way of speciation.
We are at Lake Malawi. Lake Malawi is the southernmost lake at the Syrian African Rift. The northernmost one is the Lake Kinneret in Israel. This lake is huge, unlike the Kinneret. It is huge. It's the ninth largest lake in the world. And we came here to explore the fish in this lake. The lake has very clear water. I have now taken off my beard so we can go and snorkel and have a look at all these wonderful fish.
Cichlids are, with more than 2,000 species, one of the biggest vertebrate families. In this lake, we have no less than 900 different cichlid species, most of them endemic, that live nowhere else. This lake witnessed thus an extraordinary scale of speciation. Most cichlids prefer, as you see here, to swim among the rocks that provide both protection and food. Between one rocky shore and the next are sandy shores that separate populations, which could have some effect on speciation. However, this is not the entire story. An unknown interaction between the properties of the lake and that of the cichlids led to this unique evolutionary sensation. The water here is very clear and enables cichlids to identify each other by their color pattern. It was indeed shown that females chose males by this pattern. It is possible that when a novel pattern appears by mutation, females get attracted to them. After all, the new is often exciting and attractive. From such preferences for novelty, more and more new species are generated. It is possible that sexual selection, the topic of our next video, plays a critical role in cichlid speciation. The excellent sight of cichlids and their tendency to live in clear water plays a role in their success also elsewhere. These are among the only fish that look after their offspring, something that can be done much better when it is possible to spot predators from a distance. Chromosomal changes are an effective way for generating a reproductive barrier. Genome duplication happened many times during evolution. For example, the Xenopus tropicalis toad has 20 chromosomes. The Xenopus levis toad was apparently generated by whole genome duplication and has 36 chromosomes. Chromosomes can also break into two smaller ones or translocate arms. In this karyotype, you can see the differences between a spiny mouse that lives in Israel and the one that lives in Sinai. Both rodents look very similar, but one has 18 and the other 19 chromosomes. It is easy to see that two new chromosomes were generated from one, or that one chromosome was formed by fusion of two. Apes, gorillas, orangutan, and chimpanzees all have 24 chromosome pairs. Humans, in contrast, have only 23. Here too it is evident that the differences was caused by chromosome fusion or breakage. Sometimes, mainly in plants, hybrids can form new species. For example, the wheat we eat is a hybrid that was formed by two hybridization events from three different species. The original wild wheat has 14 chromosomes, and the wheat we eat now has 42, three times as much.